Today we are here to talk about infection control and sample processing in microbiology laboratory with respect to COVID-19. Now, as we all know, COVID-19, a disease that has created havoc and a pandemic of one of its kind, has affected lives of each and every one of us. And we, the laboratory professionals, play a very important key role in providing evidence-based diagnosis to this disease by testing. So the strategy for COVID-19 has been to trace the patient, test the patient, and treat the patient. So among these three T's, the T which stands for test, as you can see, provides a very important link between testing, tracing, and treating the patient. And this is where we play an important role. So when we talk about testing, testing is for COVID-19 per se, and identification of the positive agent SARS-CoV-2 by the gold standard, that is the real-time RT-PCR. However, other supportive tests performed in microbiology, pathology, and biochemistry laboratories have an equally important role to play, and they help in patient management as well as in prognostication. Now, when we talk about these tests, as laboratory professionals, we are all apprehensive. We are anxious about handling the samples. We are scared as to what if we acquire COVID-19 during the process of handling or testing, what kind of PPE should we wear. Now, I would like to discuss all this in detail. So when we talk about handling of the sample, it's very, very important that we all know that all the specimens collected for laboratory investigation should be regarded as potentially infectious. This is what we know already, be it pre-COVID era, COVID era, or post-COVID era, this holds good. And if we keep this in mind, most of our anxieties are necessary. So due consideration has to be given to biosafety in the laboratory. So sample handling has to be done at appropriate biosafety level. Appropriate PPE, the personal protective equipment, has to be worn. And the word appropriate is very important. Not all the laboratory personnel need to wear full PPE at all time, depending upon whether it is a pre-examination process, examination, analytical process, or post-examination process. And depending on the sample type and the work we are doing, the PPE varies. So it is not necessary that we wear full PPE. Then due importance also needs to be given to biomedical waste management, which we will see in detail. So test for COVID-19, as I've already mentioned, is real-time PCR. Now, we all know that the test report can all be as good as the sample collected. So sample collection has to be done very, very meticulously. So let us see in detail what sample and how do we collect the sample for PCR for COVID-19. So the sample that needs to be collected will be collected by a healthcare worker who is trained in specimen collection. Because it is an invasive sample, that is a nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal sample, it has to be done by a trained healthcare worker. And as already emphasized, due biosafety precautions and wearing of the PPE has to be followed. So the sample which is being collected is the combination of nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swab, which is collected with the help of Dacron or nylon swabs. And both the swabs should be placed in the same container to increase the yield. Now, this is very, very important. So what all things do we need to be ready with before we have the sample collection in place? So sample collection area has to be earmarked. One should have appropriate tools for sample collection, which I've already mentioned, the swabs and the viral transport medium. You have to check the condition, if the VTM is in proper condition or not. You can visually do it by looking at the color. It has to be pink. If it is yellow or any other color other than the pink, it has to be discarded and not used. Then the test request form, or what we call as lab request form, has to be filled. Now, earlier we were using physical forms, but now ICMR has come up with RT-PCR app, and all the forms are generated electronically. However, we should keep in mind that even if it is digitalized, entering the patient particulars, be it name, age, gender, the date of sample collection, time of sample collection, including the patient contact details, especially the phone number, are very, very important. And then for packing and transportation, even the packing materials should all be arranged before we start with the sample collection. Now, in most of the places, we see that ever since the COVID pandemic has spread, there are sample collection kiosks put across in many places. They are also called as WISKs, W-I-S-K, that is walk-in sample kiosk. Now, this has an advantage because it mitigates the need for personal protective equipment. The glass which is there acts as a barrier, and one need not wear full PPE for collecting the samples. Now, in case we don't have a sample collection kiosk, we can still have an area which is earmarked for sample collection, and in that case, healthcare worker needs to wear full PPE. Now, what I mean by full PPE is, starting from top to bottom, it has to be worn. So it includes the headgear or the hood, then the goggles which cover the eyes from all aspects, like the ones which are used in swimming or skiing and not the fancy ones because they are not protective. Then comes the N95 mask, which has to be FFP2 or NIOSH certified. And if there are no goggles, even a face shield can be worn. Then a person has to wear the gown or a jumpsuit. And again, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has given guidelines with respect to the quality of the PPE. The gown has to be 75 to 90 GSM thick. Some of them also go for lamination, which is a good thing. The shoe covers also should be of the same quality as the gown. And then the gloves, which are nitrile, are advised to be worn, double gloves, and preferably the length of the gloves should be a little longer. So this is the full PPE worn. Now, apart from knowing the components of the PPE, what is more important is the sequence of donning and doffing. It's very important. If the donning and doffing is not done as per the protocol, the PPE itself can act as a source of infection to us as well as the people working in laboratory. So having worn PPE, having put in the materials in place, having filled the SRF form, and once you fill the SRF form, SRF unique SRF ID is generated, which is important for tracking the patient. So we should go ahead and collect the sample. Now, for nasopharyngeal swab, you have to make the patient sit on a chair, make him comfortable, explain the procedure. After all, it's not a pleasant experience getting your nose poked, right? So ask the patient to tilt backwards to about 70 degrees and insert the swab along with the along the floor of the nose carefully. And approximate length can be estimated by judging to the length equal to the tip of the nose to the earlobe. That should be the length you should enter inside the nasal cavity. Leave the swab in place for several seconds and then slowly remove it while rotating, and then place the swab into VTM. And once in VTM, cut off the applicator stick and close the lid. Next, you have to collect another sample from the same patient, and that is oropharyngeal swab. Now, in this procedure, you have to ask the patient to hold the tongue out and use a tongue depressor, and ask the patient to loudly say ah. When the patient says ah, it elevates the uvula and helps in sample collection. Then insert the swab and collect the sample from the posterior pharyngeal wall or the tonsillar pillars, and one should avoid touching the soft palate or tongue. Then take out the swab, and the swab has to put in the same viral transport medium into which you had put the nasopharyngeal swab. So both the swabs go into the single VTM. So after having collected this sample, most important task is labeling. So the sample has to be labeled with patient name, age, identification number, the place at which it was collected, date and time of collection. Now, why are we repeatedly telling that date, time of collection, etc. are to be mentioned at every step is because that depends, and that also affects the quality of the testing. Any delay in transportation, we can correlate. So that is why we emphasize on entering the data with respect to the date and time of collection. And at no cost should the outside of the specimen container be contaminated. We never know if there is spillage or whatever. The person who's handling next should have worn PPE and handle the specimens ideally, but as far as possible, we should not contaminate the outside of the specimen container. And the last but the most important never ever handle lab request forms with gloves. Though everything is being generated electronically, in case of bulk sample collection and transportation to a far off lab, we need to send the hard copy of the patient details as well in the form of SRFs or a line listing. In such a scenario, we should have a separate manpower or a separate personnel designated for handling the request forms. And one should never handle the lab request form with the same gloves with which the sample was collected. This is very important. Then, if you are not collecting in the same setup where the testing is going to happen, the sample needs to be stored, and one can store the sample between 2 to 8 degrees Celsius in the refrigerator for up to 48 hours. And if a longer delay is contemplated, the sample needs to be stored in minus 20 and minus 70 according to the time for which it is going to be stored. And if you are preparing next for packaging and transportation, this is how it should be done. So there are guidelines for packaging and transportation. There are WHO guidelines, ICMR guidelines, as well as IATA guidelines. So these guidelines are very, very helpful and very easy to follow to do the sample packaging. So as we can clearly see in this slide here, the person who is doing the packaging has to be wearing full PPE. Then the viral transport medium in which both the swabs are putting, the oropharyngeal and the nasopharyngeal swab, and is already labeled with the patient particular, has to be taped around the neck with the adhesive. Now again, though it is a simple task, we should be careful to just tape it once. We have seen over-enthusiastic packaging wherein the whole VTM is taped several times, and sometimes while removing, the patient particulars come out. We don't know whose sample it is, and many of the times it in fact leads to accidental spillage because it is so tightly and repeatedly taped. So these simple things should be kept in mind. After taping it, the vial goes into a primary container, and it should be covered with the absorbent material like tissue paper or cotton. Then the secondary container is then placed into a tertiary container, and if more than one sample is being collected, the tertiary containers can go into the same thermocol box or cardboard box. Then the cardboard box has to be sealed. And if at all there are physical test request forms or any other format being sent to the laboratory, it should not be mixed up and put in the same box inside along with the sample, because the box contains dry ice or gel packs. So it should be separately put in a separate ziplock and transported along with the sample. So after packaging and keeping the box ready, the next step is, again, very important, labeling of the package. Now here, the labeling has to be done with the sender's name, address, and telephone number. Whom to contact in case of emergency, very important. Suppose there is a spillage or there is inadequate sample, and if it is a crucious or a very precious sample, we have to contact and ask the concern to arrange for a repeat sample. So it's very important whom the number of the person to whom we have to contact in case of emergency has to be mentioned. Then we also have to label with the receiver's name, address, and telephone number, and label it as proper shipping with a proper label, biological substance category B and UN 3373. This is very important. Then also, if it is being filled with dry ice, the quantity of the dry ice or the temperature storage requirements if it is a gel pack need to be mentioned. And last but not to forget is to place an arrow mark like we do for other important sample transportation regarding the upright direction of the sample has to be labeled. So this completes your package. So it's a long process from sample collection to packaging, and then comes the transportation. So transportation has to be done. If it's the same lab, there is no obviously no need. But if it is being transported to a far off place, then most direct route should be used. Most of the scenarios we're seeing the sample being sent in ambulance. And again, very important is to notify the receiver well in advance about the sample being sent, especially when the bulk samples are being sent to the laboratory. You have to notify the receiver in advance so that they are better prepared, because every lab is running huge number of samples. They are already overburdened, and they may not be able to do justice to the sample if you send it without notifying prior. So prior notification has to be done, and most direct route like ambulance, for example, can be used for sending the samples. So this is about the pre-analytical process. Now let us see what happens in the second step. So once the sample is received in the laboratory, the sample is subjected to real-time PCR. So these are some of the photographs of our viral research and diagnostic laboratory at Bangalore Medical College and Research Institute. So once the sample is received, the VTM is handled inside a biosafety cabinet level 2A. And the person who is handling the sample, again, as you can see, has to wear full PPE and handle the sample. So once the sample is received, it is aliquoted. The first aliquot is used for processing. The second aliquot goes for archiving at appropriate temperature. The first aliquot is then subjected to extraction in the extraction room. So once the RNA is extracted, the template addition is done, and then it goes to the thermocycler for real-time PCR. And as I mentioned, the second aliquot, it will be kept in minus 20 or minus 80. As you can see, there is the equipment room, which has got minus 80, and this is where all the archived samples are kept. So this is how the testing happens inside the laboratory. So once the testing is done and the kits are used as per the ICMR approved guidelines only, and the reports are interpreted. So once the testing is done, so the whole process, once the sample enters the laboratory till it goes for extraction and PCR and report generation, takes about 8 hours on an average. And the targets, as I can show it in this slide here, so there are multiple gene targets, and it's E gene for screening and ORF and RDRP gene for confirmatory assay. But again, it can vary depend upon the kit, and only ICMR approved kits need to be used for testing by PCR. So once the report is generated, it is entered real time into the portal. So all the data is entered into the ICMR portal at present, and same is communicated to the concerned health officials and ministry as well. So the positive reports need to be mailed to the respective district surveillance officer within half an hour of reporting. Now here, I would like to just re-emphasize and recollect what I told previously. So mentioning the phone number of the patient, the other contact details of the patient are mandatory, because none of the reports we are handing over directly to the patient. It is all entered into the portal, and positive reports are mailed to the respective district surveillance officer. So they in turn will contact the patient. So for that, the SRF, which is filled in electronically or even otherwise physically, has to be complete, without which we cannot trace the patient. So your testing is not helping in tracing, and thereby not helping in treating. So the link is missed. So it's very important that we enter the contact details, so the patient is contacted, and then he is advised for isolation and further management. The negative reports are also entered into the portal, and that completes the process of testing. Now, a lot of work is also happening for antibody testing. And as we all know, the NIV kit for IgG ELISA is already validated and is being used for surveillance only. And please be clear that antibody testing is not done for diagnostic purpose. It is only for the surveillance purpose, especially in the high-risk areas like large migration gathering, evacuation centers or clusters or containment zones, and so on and so forth. Some hospitals are also doing it for healthcare workers, but it's only for surveillance purpose to know whether you have been exposed and have developed antibodies against SARS-CoV-2 or not. It cannot be used for diagnostic purpose. So that is about the testing of COVID-19. But as a laboratory personnel, we should also know that infection prevention and control is equally important. So in addition to standard precautions, that is the contact precautions and respiratory precautions, which need to be taken for SARS-CoV-2, other aspects like good laboratory practices, proper hand hygiene, social distancing, and appropriate of use of PPE also help in infection prevention and control. So when we talk about good laboratory practices, these are some of the practices which we all know, which appear very simple, but very difficult to follow when we actually try to implement them. So simple things like keeping the work area tidy, clean, and free of clutter, avoiding drinking and eating, and having a restricted entry in the laboratory, obviously to provide social distancing and you know, maintain a cluster-free environment, and also avoiding mobile and electronic devices to from getting distracted and thereby causing any mishap are important. And also ensuring that the supplies are stored appropriately before sample collection, we have to see whether the VTMs and swabs are adequate or not. Before starting the PCR, we should have a look at our stock and see whether the supplies for the reagents and other things are in place or not. This is very important. And then in the laboratory, the post-analytical part where we record the data, either it could be your PCR template or the result generated or the registers or the log books, the PID books, etc. They all are written documents and they should be prevented from getting contaminated by using barriers. A simple thing would be to just use a plastic cover for each of them so that they don't directly get contaminated, or we can have a proper standard operating procedure SOP in place so that at no point of time we can say that these written documents should be taken into the working lab or vice versa. So these things are very, very important to prevent the cross contamination. And in addition, the other practices like proper labeling of all the biological agents. Now, once the sample is received in the laboratory, all the laboratories give a unique lab ID. Proper lab ID has to be given, which helps in identification of the sample. SRF ID is for the patient and the lab ID is for the sample. Now, if proper labeling is not done, there can be two patients with the same names or same age, and that can lead to confusion. And there are instances which have happened in the past where labs have face difficulty and problems due to improper labeling. So proper labeling, even barcode can be used for proper labeling. Then techniques to minimize the aerosol formation. As we know, this is a respiratory borne or aerosol borne disease. So we have to minimize the techniques have to be put in place to minimize the aerosol formation. For example, if the blood sample from a COVID patient has come in for some testing, you can avoid centrifugation by allowing it to stand for some limited amount. The serum can be separated. Or if centrifugation has to be done, the lid of the centrifuge has to be closed. Many places we have seen that due to the workload and many other reasons, the centrifuge is running open, so that such practices should be avoided at any cost. Then again, other aspects like wearing the PPE, avoiding the contact of the face with the gloved hands are very important. Now, it's a human tendency to touch our face or nose with gloved hands repeatedly. And I've heard that there are certain devices in place which prevent the reflex action of your elbow while you're trying to touch your face. Even those innovations have come into place. A lot of innovations are due to COVID-19 these days. Okay, then not to forget handling of the sharps carefully and not recapping them. With COVID, other diseases have seem to have taken a backseat, but we have to keep in mind that they are still there, existing very much. So in the process of, safeguarding ourselves from COVID-19, if at all we don't give importance to needle stick injuries, there can be chances of acquiring bloodborne viruses like HIV, hepatitis B and HCV. So due importance to other laboratory practices which were in place should still be continued. Then discarding the specimens in the leak-proof container. See, testing and reporting is not the end of it. So proper discard and biomedical waste management has to be done, because we might be putting our group D or housekeeping staff at the risk of contamination. So decontamination of all the work surfaces, what we call as environmental disinfection, is also a very important part of infection control. So this environmental disinfection has to be done properly and in an approved manner. And the commonly used disinfectants are freshly prepared 1% sodium hypochlorite for a contact period of 10 minutes. Now, what is commercially available is 5% sodium hypochlorite. So if we use 4 parts of water to which we add 1 part of this commercially available 5% sodium hypochlorite, it will help us to prepare 1% sodium hypochlorite, and it has to be freshly prepared every morning. And if we are working on metallic surfaces wherein this hypochlorite can be corrosive, we can use alcohol, which is either isopropyl alcohol or ethanol, 70%, where use of bleach or sodium hypochlorite is not cannot be used. And another important thing is approved manner, I said. See, spraying of these disinfectants is highly discouraged. Even WHO has released a guideline saying only in the areas which are inaccessible, where you can't directly use sodium hypochlorite for surface disinfection using a cloth or a mop, you can use the sprayer, or sprayer should be discouraged at any cost. And even if the environmental disinfection is being done by a housekeeping staff, it is our duty as a laboratory personnel to see to it that they wear appropriate PPE and also perform hand hygiene during and after the process of environmental disinfection. Most of the places, the housekeeping staff may not be literate enough to understand the gravity and the seriousness. So it becomes our responsibility to train them in this regard. Finally, coming to biomedical waste management. Now, Karnataka State Pollution Control Board, with reference to the Central Pollution Control Board, has released guidelines which are being revised at regular intervals. So the color coding for the segregation of waste remains the same. It is being done according to the BMW 2016 guideline. However, the additional steps, what has been advocated is to use double layered bags. So earlier we used to use single layered bags for non-COVID waste. For COVID waste, we have to use double layered bags. And all the waste which is generated in the laboratory with respect to COVID-19 testing has to be labeled as COVID-19 waste. And the waste has to be stored, transported, and handed over to the respective agency separately. And also a record or a register has to be maintained in the laboratory with respect to this waste being prepared. The weight of the waste every day has to be recorded, and the laboratory can have its own checklist as to whether all these things are happening properly or not. Then even while transportation, as I said, you have to use dedicated trolley or bins and containers, and all these trolleys or bins or containers need to be washed with 1% sodium hypochlorite solution every day. And the general waste which is produced has to be separately stored in the black bags, never to be mixed with biomedical waste, and handed over separately to the municipal corporation, that is BBMP. And again, the workers, the housekeeping staff who's handling COVID waste should handle the biomedical waste and the general waste separately, and at no cost should they be mixed. So this is about the infection control part of COVID-19. So I would like to conclude saying that the laboratory personnel are no less than the soldier who are equipped with the proper tools and the gadgets like the PPE, and help the patient to seek proper treatment by providing proper testing. So I would like to say that together we can beat COVID-19. And I thank Sachidanand sir and Professor Shenoy for giving me this opportunity to speak to the audience here and convey my opinion. So if there are any questions, we can take up for a few minutes. And I also thank all the audience for their patient hearing. Please stop.
If you wanted to collect the nasal swab and the throat swab from the home, like how to organize for the sample collection, because we'll be not having proper facility to collect it if you're going in the collecting the sample in the community.
Collection at home should be avoided.
So we have to call them to the like laboratory for the sample collection.
Yes, that would be the ideal thing. Okay, there are some questions like, is there any change for infection of blood sample from COVID-19 patient? So for handling the blood sample from COVID-19 patients, as per the guidelines, we need to ask the patient, ask the person, the laboratory personnel to wear N95 mask and gloves. There is no need to wear full PPE. As we know, the virus is transmitted through secretions from the nose, the nasopharyngeal, the respiratory droplets are the main source of infection. The blood as such, except for the transient viremia, is not known to transmit. So the standard precautions, in addition to that, that is the gloves, and in addition to that, N95 mask should be worn. And as I said earlier, centrifugation has to be done carefully, because that is one procedure in the laboratory which can generate aerosols. I hope I've answered question. There is another question. How about isolation wards and quarantine center? So there are isolation wards in the hospital. So the hospital isolation wards are only for those who are proven positive, lab confirmed positive cases, where once we give the report as positive, as I said, they are admitted into the wards. And as per the recent protocols, the second sample is collected on the 10th day, and if that comes as negative, we are discharging the patient. Okay, and quarantine centers are for those who are coming from other states and other countries. Right now, for people entering into the state of Karnataka, only for people coming from Maharashtra, there is a compulsory 1 week quarantine at the quarantine centers, followed by 1 week of home quarantine. For people coming from other states, they can straight away undergo home quarantine for 14 days. And if they continue to remain asymptomatic after 14 days, the quarantine ends there. So that is a protocol which is being followed right now. Okay, there is another question. How do we disinfect isolation wards and quarantine center? So there are guidelines for a disinfection protocol from ICMR, from WHO, and even from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. The guidelines are available. So for isolation wards, because we are admitting the known positive patient there, meticulous SOP, the standard operating procedure, has to be in place. Each hospital can have its own infection control policy with respect to COVID-19. We at Victoria Hospital have a policy in place, and as per that only we are doing the environmental disinfection. So there is a separate SOP for laundry, separate SOP for frequent touch surfaces, SOP for surface cleaning, and so on and so forth. I don't think we can discuss in detail, and if you want, I can share my mail ID, we can share the SOPs, or else, as I said, all the guidelines are already available on the website. Surface cleaning has to be done with 1% sodium hypochlorite, and only in the areas inaccessible, spraying is done. And metal surfaces, we need to use 70% alcohol. I hope that answers your query regarding disinfection of isolation wards. Okay, the next question is there a COVID-19 rapid antibody test? As I've told earlier, a lot of rapid antibody kits are coming into market, but none of them have received the ICMR approval as of today. And ELISA-based kits, which already are validated by ICMR, are being used only for surveillance purpose and not for diagnostic purpose. So the answer would be no. There is no COVID-19 rapid antibody test which can be used for diagnosis. The next question is, what in the case of asymptomatic with the PCR positive? As per the guidelines, the asymptomatic personnel, there is no need to test, right? But if at all you belong to high risk category, let us say a laboratory personnel who has worked in the laboratory, or a asymptomatic person who has worked in the quarantine facility or in the hospitals, the testing can be done. And if it is asymptomatic, but the PCR says positive, as per the rules of the state, the person, even though asymptomatic, has to be admitted in the facility or the hospital meant for COVID-19. So that is the protocol. And again, 10th day, we take a repeat sample. The swab is taken and subjected to testing. If one swab is turned negative on the 10th day, the person can be discharged. That is the policy which is being followed right now.
You are okay. One more question. According to the asymptomatic patient, yes, actually, we are not tested for the COVID-19 based on like RT-PCR for that asymptomatic patient. But okay, he'll act as a carrier for some times. But how long that virus will be present in his body?
Okay, so there have been, on an average, we can say that the PCR positivity will be there for up to 14 days. That is why earlier protocol was to test for two consecutive times, one on the 8th or 9th day and again on the 13th day. If both the reports are negative, the person was discharged. Right, but now the policy has changed and we test on the 10th day. But there have been instances in which the patient can test positive for PCR even on the 25th day, 30th day. In our own setup, we have seen that the patient has continued to remain positive for even 30 days. So there is no clear-cut, guideline, but on an average, it should not be more than 2 weeks. Okay, there is another question. Is it true that after recovering from COVID-19, the patient can again be infected with COVID-19? So this is actually a tricky question. So it can either be a case of reinfection or reactivation. So even this virus, as we know, is intermittently shed. And if the sampling, and as I told earlier, the test report is as good as the sample collected, even our gold standard at present has its own limitations. So just because a person tested negative, it's not mandatory that he need not test positive. So there are instances in which the patient can test positive again after testing negative. So that can either be due to reactivation or reinfection. We can't clearly say. Most of the cases, it is just a limitation of the test, I would say. Okay, there is another question. Is there any antigen testing like HIV? As of now, no. There is no rapid test for antigen detection like we have for dengue or HIV or hepatitis B. Nothing has come into clinical use as of now. Okay, so I think we can close the session. I thank you all for your active participation and giving me the opportunity to present in front of you. Thank you. We would end the meeting now.